Praise the Lord, saints. We thank God for another time of being able to come together to celebrate his goodness, to reflect his awesome presence and all that he has done for each and every one of us. If you have a cell phone, I'm going to ask you to take a moment to put it on silent for us as we prepare to worship the Lord and give him glory and honor and adoration. He has been on his job all day long taking care of us. He has not slipped at all. He's been right there watching over us and helping us with every step we've taken. And we are grateful and thankful, and that's why we're here tonight again to lift him up and magnify his awesome name and to give him glory and praise because he's worthy. We're going to worship the Lord tonight and lift him up. And Sister Edna is preparing to come and to lead us. Sister Lorinda is already in place. And you are here. And we thank God for each one of you. You are the on-time saints. And we bless God for you. We want to let you know how much we appreciate your on-timeness. Amen. And I thank God that you value being on time. And because you value being on time, we start on time. And we're not going to wait for those who are late. We want to make them feel late when they come in so that the next time they will be on time. And being that hasn't helped in the past, hopefully somehow it might help them in the future. Praise God. Amen. Let's bow our heads together. We're going to pray, and then Sister Edna is going to come, and we are going to worship the Lord in this place. Father, we thank you so much so, because we see in every day your hand at work. It is true that every morning we wake up, new mercies we see. And we want to just celebrate you today, because you are right there with your hand wide open to minister to us and to take care of every need we have. So we just want to just rejoice in you and celebrate you tonight. And even as we sing and lift up our hands and clap and worship you, we pray, God, that you'll receive our worship and that you might be honored and glorified and pleased to move in our midst, to take care of every need we have. Somebody may have come in tonight and they may be in pain, but we're asking in the name of Jesus that you will not allow them to remain in pain. And that during the time of our worship, you would move in such a way that that pain will be taken away. Whatever the issues are that we came in with, God, we are asking that in the name of Jesus that you will give us peace, knowing that that situation is in your hands and that you are working on it for your glory. That when we leave this place, we will have the assurance that what we are asking you for, we have it in the name of Jesus. Minister to us through those who will lead, those who will play on the instruments. Minister through those who will work with the streaming media ministry. We just lift up all of this in your hands and trust it to your care. Meet us in this place, God. Our coming will have been in vain if we do not sense that you are here with us. So speak into our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Sister Edna, come. Praise be to our great King.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. What a blessing it is to be in the house of the Lord. I thank the Lord for off days. Those of us that continue to work, we know what that is. What a blessing it is to have an off day and not lose anything on it. We thank the Lord. We give God glory. Whoever created benefits, we thank the Lord for that one. We're going to look at our song sheets that reminds us that we are overcomers. Whatever we're facing, whatever test or trial, whatever problem you care you have, nothing is too hard for our God. Sits high, looks low, and the words that he knows what we need even before we ask or think of it. He already knows. So let's sing about being an overcomer. Over everything, over all things, overcomer in Christ Jesus. Praise the Lord. Amen. Feel free to clap your hands, pat your feet, give him a wave, nod your head, give a shout. Be an overcomer today in Christ Jesus. Amen. Oh,
it's all because of Jesus. All because of Jesus. It's all say yes. Hallelujah. Let the church give him praise. All because of Jesus. All because of him that we are here. And we thank God. If you have a few dollars in your pocket, if you have some bread on your table, if you have a roof over your head, if you have a shirt on your back, it's all because of him, because he made it possible. Don't give yourself a pat on the back saying, oh, I did, oh, I have, oh, I'm so smart. I'm so. Oh, no, not at all, but because of him, because of goodness and mercy, we have it as well as we do. Because of him, we didn't suffer what we could have suffered. Because of him, we didn't get the just reprimand, punishment that we rightly deserved, but because of him. And he's worthy. If we could just take our hands and just give him a wave of praise and thanksgiving, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. 10,000 tongues would not be enough, but just thank you, Lord, for all that you do and all that you continue to do. To be able to stand, be able to come to worship, to be able to be in your house. When we hear on the news about countries and people that are punished and reprimanded for not being able to worship you. But we have a freedom and liberty that we can give you glory, honor, and praise freely and open without restrictions. Oh, we thank you, God. And you're worthy of all of it. And we give you the praise. And I thank you, Jesus. And as we prepare to go to prayer, we glorify him because he's just that kind of God. He is a father that remembers his children. He remembers each and every one of us. Your problem is just as important to him as my problem. And he remembers each and every one of us. And he knows what we stand in need of. And what a wonderful thing to know. We don't have to carry all these cares. We don't have to carry all these burdens and tests and trials. We don't have to depend on what the doctor says and what the lawyer says and what the law says, even what the president says. My hope is not in the White House. My hope is in God. And I thank him tonight. Saints, if you have a need, and you want to be remembered tonight, you can quickly share it. I want to share an urgent call that came to me before coming. Sister Maria Nunez, that we recently ministered to, we were able to go and share with her and give her food and things that she needed. Well, she's facing a serious situation. Evidently, she's being wrongfully accused of harboring and helping a gang member. She knows them. She at some point she was befriending them. She had shared with the sisters. She would minister to some of them and try to help them change their lives. And the other night, one was on the run and the police were after them. He banged on her door, but they did not open the door. He threw something in her patio, a bag of something in the patio, and took off. Well, she didn't go outside and she kept her children inside. But for whatever reason, the landlord believes that she harbored or helped him. And today she called me crying, saying that she received a 90-day eviction notice. But you know, we know God is able. And as I talked to her and I shared with her, striving to calm her down, striving to let her know and remind her where our help comes from. This is where our help comes from. You know, the law could say anything to any one of us to try to put us on the street, to try to put us anywhere. But we know where our help comes from. And I'm asking you to remember her in prayer. We're going to do our best to continue to minister to her. I told her I would let you know, Pastor, and we're going to follow through to try to help. I told her, don't worry about that. God has some. You know, I remember a long time ago crying over a job, Pastor Leon. But you know, I learned I had to lose that job for the Lord to bless me with a better. You know, sometimes we crying over holding on to this little thing here because this is what we're used to. But God has taken it from us by whatever means necessary to bless us with something better. So remember Maria and her children in prayer. When I talked to her, encouraged her, I hung on the phone. She felt encouraged. And we're going to continue. Quickly stand, saints, if there's a prayer, share. Four-year-old Jacob in the hospital. They don't know what's wrong, but we know God is able. Okay. Mm-hmm. Sister Burns healing. We know God is able. Any other requests? Just Lynette. Remember Sister Lynette and where she lives. God continue to protect her and keep her. Mm-hmm. Sister Gina. Sister Gina's sister, healing with the headaches. We know God is able. If there's no other spoken request, unspoken. Yes, Sister Alex. Mm-hmm. Yes. We're going to remember Sister Laster, healing in her body, her daughter, Yolanda. Mm-hmm.
Police have kind of backed up because of
Yes, in Baltimore. We know God is able. We know God is able. Saints, we can't take anything for granted. We can't take anything for granted. But we know God is good. And spoken request by elevation of your hand. God sees our hands. He knows what the lead that hand represents. And he's able and willing to meet us there. And it's all because of Jesus. It's all because of Jesus. All his wonderful blessings, marvelous blessings, that we are here. We're going to sing that little chorus one more time.
I'm going to ask Pastor Leon, would you take us to prayer tonight? We know God is able.
It's all because of Jesus. It's all because of Jesus. Oh, because of Jesus, we are here. All his many blessings. All his many, his wonderful blessings.
Most holy God, our heavenly Father, we come before you now in the name of Jesus to say thank you. Thank you for your mercy and thank you for your grace. Thank you for what is truly an unconditional love. Thank you for being in this place today, and Father, we thank you for where we are in our life today. Father, things could be so much worse than they are. But where we are, Lord God, we have Jesus. Where we are, Lord, you are. And Father, we just lift up our hearts in worship and praise and thanksgiving as we come before you with our cares and with our petitions, asking you by your Spirit, in your wisdom and in your knowledge, Father, to move in a very special way concerning our requests. Father, there's healing, Lord God, that we're asking for in our bodies. Father, in the name of Jesus, we know first and foremost you are a healer, and that, Father, you are a comforter, you are a strength giver, a peace giver. Lord God, we're faced with any and all kinds of ailments, and so move by your Spirit to help us, Lord God, individually. These are individual needs. You take care of us individually, understanding who we are. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that you would pour out your healing even now. We lift up, Lord God, Maria and her situation. And Father, in the name of Jesus, we're asking you to move by your Spirit again, to encourage her, to strengthen her, to challenge her in the ways of the Lord. We're asking you to move, Lord God, in a very special way because she has children. And children, Lord God, you don't want on the street. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, we're asking you, Lord God, to provide a way, open a door, fix this situation, Lord God, as we give it into your hands. And oh God, as we look at the situation, Lord God, concerning little Jacob, 4 years old, the doctors can't figure it out, but you can. You knew what it was about before he got there. You knew, Lord God, the time, the minute, down to the second he would be in the hospital. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, move by your Spirit, Lord God, to touch this child and to touch this family and to, Lord, please save them from sorrow upon sorrow and grief upon grief. Would you move by your Spirit to touch his little body even now? To lift him up and to lift him out, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. And Father, we lift up the situation in Baltimore. And Father, in the name of Jesus, we're asking you to move by your Spirit. Oh, Lord God, sin is the problem. Sin is the issue. It's not a white or black situation. Lord, it's a sin situation. So we're asking you to move in a very special way, Lord God, and cause folk to understand, Lord God, they're responsible in many ways for the outcomes and the situations that they find themselves in. Would you move in a very special way, Lord God, to bring the people and bring the police force, if you will, together again. Oh, Lord God, where the people might be able again to trust and the officers might feel free to go in and do what they're called to do. God is going to take you by your Spirit to work in that situation. Men have already tried to figure out, work out the situation, and it just got worse. So move by your Spirit in the name of Jesus. And oh, Lord God, fix it. Save some young lives, oh God, that could be destroyed because of this, the circumstance and the situation in Baltimore. Remember the churches who are trying to help. The people of God, Lord God, who are trying to minister. Oh God, give wisdom and give courage. Rest your anointing, Lord God, on the people of God that they might have, oh God, a word of prophecy, a word of knowledge, a word, Lord God, of encouragement, oh God, to lift these people, Lord God, from the mindset and from the situation that they found themselves in. We give this situation into your hands. And we lift up our sick and our shut in. We're asking you to move by your Spirit, Lord God, and just sit beside them and let them feel your presence. We lift up our lost family and friends. And oh God, move in a very special way. Oh Lord, to begin to open up the heart as you give us a word, Lord God, that might begin the process of salvation. Father, all of these things, Lord God, we know are just a small thing concerning all that you take care of 24 hours a day. You keep this world, Lord God, on its axis. You keep this universe operating in the way that it should. And so, Lord, in the name of Jesus, these are small things that we're coming to you with. We give them into your hands. We trust them to your care. We say thank you now for what you're going to do to give a testimony, oh God, to the glory of who you are. Hallelujah. Oh God, we give it into your hands. And Father, we lift up Lynette and her situation. We ask you, Lord God, to fix this situation concerning the apartment complex, the tenants, whatever the strife and whatever is going on. Father, you're able. And so, Father, we just say thank you for what you're going to do to give her peace, to give her an answer, and to give her a way, Lord God, that is pleasing unto you. We just ask for your Spirit to rest upon Lynette and lead her and guide her in the way that she should go. And so, Lord God, let your Spirit rest in this place. I have to lift up, Lord God, the Life Center. And I'm asking you in the name of Jesus, Lord God, as we continue to cry out to you. We thank you for giving us patience as you work things out. We're asking you, Lord God, to lift up Pastor Robinson and our leadership, Lord God, giving us wisdom on which way to go. And we're praying, Father, in the name of Jesus, that in the meantime, oh God, you would cause us to rest in the excitement of what you're able to do for us, oh God, in this day and in this time and for this world today. There's something on your heart. There's something on your mind. There's a work that you're tailoring for us. And we just ask that you would prepare us for the task that we have. And rest your anointing on us, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. And so we glorify you, Most High God. We lift up the name of Jesus, that name that is above every name, that one day every knee shall bow, both in heaven and in earth, Lord God, and under the earth, everyone would come to give him glory, to give him praise, to honor him for the God and Savior that he is. We say thank you. Thank you for the name Jesus. Thank you for the person of Jesus. Thank you for the Spirit of Jesus. Oh God, that keeps us, that helps us, strengthens us, and provides for us. We give you praise right now. And just asked you, Father, to have your way. Have your way. As we say thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you, God. We can just thank him before it happens, because we know where our help comes from. Before Pastor brings the word tonight, our prayer should be, our desire to should be, fill me, Lord. Fill me, Lord, with your Spirit. Fill me with your love, with your power, with your might, with your grace, your mercy, your strength, your joy. Fill me, Lord. Decrease me that you will increase. I say, Lord, when I go out to work and I go out to the public and community, Lord, let me so walk and let me so live that they will see you before they see me. Because it's about you. And it's not about me. Praise God. The song is on your song sheet. If you remember it from before, sing it with me. Those of you that are learning it, you'll quickly catch on.
Your spirit.
out your spirit, and I will open up inside. Fill me up. I want you to fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up. Fill me up. I want you to fill me up. I need you to fill me up, God. Fill me up. Fill me. What we want tonight, saints. We want him to fill us. We want him to purge us. Lord, I want you to take everything out of me that is not pleasing to you. I want you to remove every hindrance, every stumbling block, and help me to come over to just where you want me to be what you want me to be, to walk in where you want me to walk, to talk where you want me to talk, to live the way you want me to live. That's our desire. That's what we want you to do, Lord. That's what we crave for, Lord. Hallelujah. Love of God. Sing this with me.
That's exactly what God wants to do. He wants to fill us up so that he could use us to do what he wants done in all the earth. And that is to bring light into darkness, to bring life so that death can be eradicated, to bring wholeness and newness and healthiness and love where hate abounds, that his glorious name might be praised, that he might be honored, and we will rejoice. He wants to fill us up. Hallelujah. Thank you, Sister Edna, for leading us in worship. Thank you for introducing us to that song. And it's the words are so meaningful, so wonderful, so poignant, so necessary, so God-inspired, so scripturally based. We thank God. Thank God for Sister Lorinda, who plays so skillfully on the instrument. Amen. We thank those of you who are so faithful. I don't know what we would do without you. I guess we would cry to God for help. We thank God for you. Praise God. Amen. We bless the Lord. It is so good to be able to be in the house of the Lord again tonight to celebrate his goodness, to worship him, to honor him, and to delight ourselves in him. He is our source of strength. He is the very keeper of our souls. And there is nothing that we could ever achieve without him that is good or eternal. And so he is worthy of all the praise that we can offer him. On Sunday, we shared from the theme or the title, Giant Proofing Your Walk. And I want to quickly just take a look at a few things in there and then share a few more things with you to help you and to grant myself some help that we might actually do what the song inspires us to do, or at least to desire. And I want you to, you know, sometimes when we preach, there is no time for interaction. And so there can be some things that are said that may at the moment be cloudy for you. Usually pastors. Day forward. Okay? And so we gave a number of different examples of things that happened in his life. And I want to quickly reiterate those things that we saw in this story of David as it relates to his courageous feats with the lion and the bear, his incredible faith, courage, and anticipation concerning his encounter with Goliath, his music that ministered to King Saul and drove away the evil spirit that troubled him, and then his humble and respectful responses to King Saul's jealous attempts to kill him. We said that in order for somebody to be able to operate in that vein, they could not have possibly done it in their own ability and strength. It had to be the anointing that was upon him that caused him to be able to have the courage, to have the faith, and to have that kind of anticipation that if he acted, God was going to move on his behalf. Takes an anointing to be able to operate in that vein. And we saw that David did some things that were just beyond extraordinary, that we ourselves, even as believers, I want you to think about that for a moment, and we demonstrated on Sunday how when the lion and the bear came in and took one of the sheep from the flock and sort of just walked away with it, you know, with us, and I'm just being honest, I'm being real, we would have just let him walk away. Amen. Amen. And some of us, we would not have just let him walk away. We would have run away in the opposite direction. Is that right? That's right? That would have been our natural reaction.
Amen.
Amen. It's like when, you know, somebody breaks in your house in the front door. You immediately remember where the back door is, and you are out of it immediately. It is very rare that we would take a stand when our life may be in danger. So it has to be something that is happening within us of the supernatural activity of God that causes us to do what David did. And I said it's tied to his anointing when Samuel anointed him and the Spirit of God came upon him from that day forward. It had to be. When everybody, like we said, when everybody else is running from Goliath, David can't wait to run out and fight him. And he's not even a warrior. He's not even a full-grown man. He's a youth, as Saul said. He's probably a teenager. And he's ready to go out and fight when hardened warriors are not. As a matter of fact, we know that the scripture says that King Saul was taller than everybody else in Israel at the time, from his shoulders up. That means the tallest person in the kingdom came up to his shoulders, and he wasn't willing to go out and fight. Remember, the scripture says everybody in Israel, when the giant came out and said what he said, everybody in Israel was dismayed and fearful. And David is saying, let me at him. Let me at him. He wants to go and fight Goliath. There's something supernatural happening within him that's tied to his anointing and tied to the Spirit of the Lord coming upon him. We shared that on Sunday. And then we took a look at a number of other characters in Scripture that we know that the Spirit of God came upon and how they were transformed. We took a look at Bezalel in Exodus chapter 31, verse 1 and following. We took a look at Samson. The Spirit of the Lord came upon him, and he had incredible strength in Judges chapter 13 and 14. We took a look at King Saul. Samuel anointed him as well, even before he anointed David, and shared with him what was going to happen for them, and he actually became another man. It absolutely transformed his life. And then we took a look at the prophecy of Joel in chapter 2, verse 28 and following, and we noted the people and the gifts that would be given to these people once the Spirit of the Lord came upon them and how they would be transformed. I didn't make mention of the fact that we saw that these kinds of things were not just happening to the apostles. Oftentimes people think that these kinds of things just happened with the apostles. They did not just happen with the apostles. They happened with a number of people. As you read the story in the book of Acts, this happened with a number of people. As a matter of fact, on one of their journeys, Luke is recording the journey, they happened to stop by Philip the evangelist's house. And he had four daughters that prophesied. All four of them prophesied, which is in keeping with the prophecy in the book of Joel in chapter 2, that your sons and your daughters will prophesy. And this thing is being played out. It's coming to life in the book of Acts, and it's happening in people that you wouldn't think it would ordinarily happen with. When people prophesied, they were often prophets. When people were anointed and the Spirit of God came upon them, it was often kings and special people. It wasn't these kinds of people. But the prophecy says that God is going to pour out his Spirit upon all flesh. And we see it beginning, beginning in the book of Acts. Not beginning and ending, beginning in the book of Acts. People, oftentimes, whole denominations believe it began and ended in the book of Acts. I do not believe that. I believe that God is still doing this, and he's doing it in hearts that are open to him. All right? And then we took a look at Pentecost and what actually happened on the day of Pentecost and how this thing began to happen and how Peter, standing up before the people, tied the event and the things that happened in that event to the prophecy in Joel chapter 2, verse 28. He says, this is that which the prophet Joel spoke of. In the last days, saith the Lord, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And even upon your servants and your handmaidens will I pour out of my Spirit. And he's saying, this is going to touch everybody who's open to me, from the most noble citizen that believes on me to the humblest of servants. I'm going to pour my Spirit out upon all flesh. Now, the thing that, let me stop and pause there for a moment, because maybe somebody might have a question or a comment concerning something that I might have shared on Sunday, or you have a question tonight concerning that. But let me just pause for just a moment and see maybe if you have a comment or a question before I go on, because what Jesus made mention of is going to become even more important to us as I share the following thoughts, okay? You have a question or a comment? I want to give you a moment. Sister Laster? Saul, King Saul. Yes, he was Saul at the time, and he was being anointed by Samuel. You'll find that in 1 Samuel chapter 10, verse 6, all right, that he became another man, or at least he was anointed and prophesied, and the passage says he will become another man. All right, any other questions concerning what we shared on Sunday, or if a question arose tonight, in your heart or in your mind, or if you have a comment? Remember, this is the time to interact. Want to make sure that we understand what the Spirit of the Lord is trying to convey to the church and why it's so important. Okay? Now, hopefully you'll have some questions as we go on a little further, but seeing no hands, I'll take it a little further now. Now remember, on the day of Pentecost, the 120 followers of Christ who have obeyed what he has said about going down to Jerusalem and remaining there until they be endued with power from on high, they are there in the upper room in obedience to the command of their Lord. And we know the outflow and everything that happens in Acts chapter 2, where the Spirit of the Lord comes upon them and they are filled with the Spirit of God, and then they begin to speak in other languages. And in this event, there are people that hear them in the street. The word gets out as quickly as it can possibly get out in that day. You know, if it happened today, everybody around the world would know it because we'd be able to text everybody in a hot second. But the word spread quickly, and people started to gather as these people began to flow out of the upper room down into the streets, and they're still speaking in these languages, and the people are responding. And it is important to understand why Jesus gave the command. Go down to Jerusalem and wait. Go down to Jerusalem and wait. Do not go anywhere. Do not do anything. Do not, you know, scatter and just do what you want to do. Excuse me. It is important that you go down to Jerusalem and wait until you are endued with power from on high. Because this is the preparation for what's coming. This is the preparation for what's coming. Not to follow the command of Christ and to be endued with power on high means not to be prepared for what's coming. We got to get that. If we don't do what he says, if we don't receive what he's about to give, we are not prepared for what is coming. Remember now, we were talking about giant-proofing your walk. Because for all of us in every age, there are giants that we are facing. And Jesus has the solution for every giant in every age. And it's not a different solution either. It's the same solution. It's the same solution. It was the solution in the Old Testament for David, and it's the solution in the New Testament for the apostles, and it's the same solution today. It is being endued with power from on high so that we can deal with the giants that we face. That's important. Now I want you to think with me for just a moment, and maybe you'll have a few more than I will have, but let's think for just a moment. He sends them down to Jerusalem to stay there and wait there until they be endued with power from on high, because Jesus knew the giants they would be facing. The question that we have to consider is, what were those giants that they would be facing? Okay, Michelle says persecution. Persecution was one of the giants they would be facing. That's important. Why is that important? Because we don't do very well with persecution in our own strength.
Amen.
Amen. Now let's think about that for just a moment. In our own strength, if we know that we are going to be beaten with rods, are we going to go and do what we're supposed to do?
No.
No. If we do go and do what we're supposed to do, and somebody beats us with rods, in our own strength, what do we want to do? We want to beat them with rods. Am I right?
Yes.
In your own strength, when somebody slaps you upside the head, you want to slap them back upside the head. As a matter of fact, you want to punch them. You don't want to slap them. You want to hurt them more than they hurt you. So Jesus, knowing the giants that this early new form church would face, he knew that there had to be a giant that was greater living in them than the giants that they were going to have to face.
We giant-proof our walk through the same way that God has always giant-proofed believers' walks, by having the Spirit of God living within us in power, being endued with power from on high to face our giants. So if one of the giants is persecution, and Michelle is so right with that, as a matter of fact, I got that in my notes. That's number three for Michelle. It's not in any order, but I do have it in my notes, dealing with persecution. And I note it in its cruelest forms. We actually think we're being persecuted today. When Paul gives his list of things that he has gone through, I'm thinking, man, that's a long list of persecution. And when you read that list and you start checking them off, I'm thinking, like, where would I have bailed out? You know what I mean? Where would I have stopped preaching the gospel with all of this happening to me over and over and over again? He wasn't just beaten once. Paul, listen. He tells, there were three times I was beaten with stripes, you know, and saved one, 40 stripes, saved one. There were times he was literally in the ocean for a day and a night. There were times when he was hungry, not from fasting. He was denied food. He was in prison. He was stoned. I mean, we go down the list. Where would you have bailed out? Some of us are bailing out and we're not even being persecuted. Yeah, when the food ran out. When the chicken stopped coming. Huh? We're not even being persecuted and we're folding. Jesus knew that they would be facing giants and they needed to be endued with power from on high. What might some of the other giants be that he knew that they would be facing? My. Yeah.
First of all, they selected him.
Yes.
So having to deal with the perhaps guilt that, you know, we were the ones that selected him.
Yes.
To handle that task.
Yes.
And just to watch him be murdered.
Sure.
Right in front of their
yeah.
eyes.
Yeah. So stoned to death.
You know, that could have been a quitting moment for anyone.
Sure. Sure. You wonder, like, what? How is this happening? We are serving you, God, and somehow, for some reason, you're letting these people stone him. That's kind of hard to take when you know that God has the ability and the power to just stop it. And he lets them do it. And you're watching this. And it's hitting you hard. You got to have something in you that's going to keep you keeping on when you witness those kinds of things. What other giants might they be facing that they would need this endowment from on high?
To discern false prophets.
To discern false teaching or false prophets. That you can be so easily swallowed up in teaching and sharing because obviously there were people that were giving words that were prophetic, but weren't coming from Christ. There were people that were teaching things that were not coming from Christ. And if you don't have the ability, see, sometimes it's not head knowledge. It's not even book knowledge. It's discernment.
Amen.
It's discernment, which is a part of that endowment, because that is a gift of the Spirit to us as believers, to be able to discern whether or not God is really working here.
Amen.
Amen. And so this endowment from on high is so necessary, because if there were false prophets in their day, and I've said this before, in this hellish world we live in now, there's got to be more false prophets than they had then. And some of them
are pastoring churches. Some of them are on the radio and TV. And some of the teaching people are swallowing up because there is no ability to discern. They don't know the word, and then there's no ability to discern. And then we wonder why people are believing all kinds of crazy things, because there's no real endowment of the Spirit from on high. No empowering, no gifting that's happening in the lives of people. And so they gullibly go along with what they hear. It's amazing what some people will listen to. It's amazing what some people will follow. You know, if you end up in Guyana drinking punch, some of you are very familiar with Jim Jones, but if you end up in Guyana drinking punch, and you've been duped into believing what he had been teaching, something's wrong. Something's wrong. Somewhere you've left the text. Somewhere you're not listening to the Spirit of God telling you that this is not the right way to go. Something is seriously wrong. Yes. Yes. Oh Lord, yeah, and they charge you for it. Jesus help us. Well, it is obvious, even just looking at just a few of those giants, it is obvious that there is a need for that endowment. Is that right? Let me share another giant with you that is incredible. Because when we talk about giants, we are talking about things, forces, or whatever that cannot be overcome through human instrumentality. All right? That's what we're talking about, a giant. A giant is anything that cannot be overcome through human instrumentality. It's like a demon-possessed person. There's nothing you can do in your human strength to eradicate him. It takes the power of God operating in you to move that demon out of that person. Amen. You could try all day long in your own strength. The demon will sit there laughing at you all day long. Amen. Demons don't get tired. You get tired sitting there all day long trying, but he doesn't get tired. He laugh at you all day long, and he will frustrate you to death. But when he recognizes that the Spirit of God is upon you and God's anointing is upon you, he fears you. He fears you, because demons don't like to just wander about. They want a body to possess. Huh? That's why when Jesus was about to cast the demons out of the man, they insisted. They pleaded, they implored him not to send them out, to please let us go into this herd of swine. They'd rather go into pigs than to just wander around outside of a body. They fear you because they know if you cast them out, where are they going? It's like they're useless unless they have a body. They're looking for something or someone to possess. They fear you. Yeah, they came to Jesus. They were trembling when they fell down before. They're trembling. Are you come to torment us before the time, they ask? Huh? They're trembling. Yeah, and that's the one I have listed first. They are given the task of trying to literally change the Judaistic mindset of these people and introduce Jesus to a people that are enamored with Old Testament law. You talk about a giant. That is a giant. That is a giant. That's where the persecution's coming from. It's going to come from them trying to literally turn this big, big elephant over in the room, turn him upside down, and then skin him. Can you imagine? Now, think about this. Paul was a brilliant man. He was a brilliant man. He was taught at the feet of Gamaliel. And he, by saying that, spoke highly of Gamaliel. That by him saying that he sat at the feet of Gamaliel was to say something very good about Gamaliel. Gamaliel was not the only teacher in this Judaistic mindset. They had other brilliant teachers. And now Paul gets converted, and he's got some fishermen helping him. And he's going to try to overturn this whole mindset that has been in place for thousands of years. The task is dropped in your lap. You better be endued with power from on high, because it's going to take the Spirit's wisdom to speak something into these people's lives to help them to believe that what you're bringing now is actually from God. That's a giant. Is that a giant? Yes, it is a giant. Because most of the trouble that they encountered, they were encountering it from those who were tied to Judaism. As a matter of fact, when Paul went to one city and they heard he was there, they came down there to make sure he was persecuted there. Soon as he left there and went to another city, they followed him to the next city and made sure he was persecuted and kicked out of that city. They were following him everywhere. Judaistic mindset. This religious mindset that was causing him all kinds of trouble. Yeah. Yeah. That's right. Sure it is. And it was for them. That's a part of that Judaistic mindset that now they are confronting with the hope that they would change, because as the scripture says, Paul said this himself, they went about to establish their own righteousness, and they rejected the righteousness that came through faith in Christ Jesus. This was God's righteousness that God is trying to give to them, but they rejected it to go about to establish their own righteousness. That's what they were doing, and they were stubborn in it. And the Apostle Paul, with his best teaching, was not convincing them. That's a giant. He's confronted with a giant. One of the other giants is to take the gospel to the world where people had never heard about Jesus. That's a giant. That's a giant. It's hard for some of us to take the gospel to people who have heard about Jesus. They have the task of actually taking the gospel to people who don't even know anything about Jewish law, anything about God, and anything about a Savior and a Redeemer, anything about sacrifices. They're taking the gospel to a world where people speak different languages, have different cultures, and act totally different from the Jewish mindset. So not only are they dealing with the Judaistic religion that's totally different from Christianity, now they're dealing with people that are totally different from anything they've ever known. What a giant that is. Think you can do that in your own strength? It's hard to take the gospel to homies in the hood that you grew up with, let alone taking it to people around the world that don't even know anything about Jesus. Now, when you hear that command, I want you to go down to Jerusalem, and I want you to stay there until you be endued with power from on high. Now you understand more fully why. Because they are going to face giants that they will never be able to conquer in their own strength. Is that right? How many of you would like to have this as a job description given to you? And you just are pushed out and they say, I wish you the best. In your own strength. And how far would you go? I don't know about you, but I would go. Immediately I would go. Straight home. Straight home. I wouldn't go anywhere but home. I'd lock the doors. I'd close the shutters. I'd shut the curtains. I'd go straight home. Because you recognize right away there is no way that you could do this in your own strength. And so Jesus saw as the solution the same thing he saw way back in the Old Testament for David, for King Saul, for the prophets, for Bezalel. When you go down the list, that spirit came upon them because of the giant task that faced them, that they were going to have to take care of through the empowerment of that spirit. So the question is, as we take a look a little further, well, let me pause for just a moment and ask if there's any questions concerning anything that we just said, but let's go on a little further after any questions or comments. Because these giants, remember now, they are only giants if they are things and they are forces, they are entities that cannot be overcome or conquered through human instrumentality. That's how they become giants. That's a giant. And you can see by the list of things we talked about, there's no way that they could have ever conquered through their human strength the things that were before them. Okay? They needed this endowment from on high. I saw Sister Gina's hand.
And his wife that originally in Florida they had a church. He was the pastor, and he said that the church was growing but not really, and then all of a sudden the word came where the Lord was sending them both to just go around the world and play the I think the viola. Which is not the violin, but the faster one, the viola, I think it is. Anyway, it's kind of like a violin, but they the beat, the sound is a little bit different. It's like an alto. And so anyway, so and the wife, she doesn't sing, but she dances. And so they just began to prepare. And where the Lord had been sending them, now they have been in ministry for about 15 years, is to garbage dumps in Central and South America. They actually mention about the one in Honduras, in Tegucigalpa. And he says, only the power of God could enable us to communicate with people through music where they don't speak their language. Because even if they go to places where Spanish could be the language, they could talk a little bit, but because there's so many dialects in some of the areas, but through music, they winning souls to Christ. So all they do is play, he plays the instrument, she dances for the people, and people are just drawn to, you know, to, and before they know, they lead them into the prayer of salvation, and they're receiving Christ. And the other thing that struck me right now and just putting it together was that she used to work for a very famous perfume company back in the days. And she said, so he says, for my wife to be able to go from smelling good all the time and working with perfume all the time to now she literally sits with the people in the garbage dumps in those areas. And he has vomited several times, but she just combs the women's hair, and that she doesn't smell anything. It's like a special anointing is on her to where she doesn't smell anything. So I was, it just came to me. So I thought I'd share that.
That is awesome. That's that endowment, that anointing, that spirit upon you that causes you to be able to do those kinds of things, because in your own self, you wouldn't do that. You just can't do that. God anoints you for that particular service, that particular ministry, that particular work. It's an incredible thing that God does, because God knows where he's sending us and the giants that we will encounter. That's why it's important for us to understand that while it is the same spirit that anoints us and that fills us, that spirit's work can be different in each one of us. You know, it's often the error that often fills churches that if you don't get it like I got it, you don't have it. If you don't operate in it like I operate in it, then I don't think you really have the same spirit. No, this spirit. Remember, the one thing that is constant is that we need that one spirit. But the way that that one spirit works in each individual could be very different. And we have to be open and understanding that it is the spirit that calls the shots, not us. We don't tell the spirit what to do. The spirit beckons us to do what he is whispering in our hearts to do. And we will be better off if we just went ahead and did what he told us to do, even if it doesn't make sense to you. See, going into a country and just playing music and dancing doesn't make sense. Amen. And some of us would probably be wondering, why is she dancing anyway? She shouldn't be dancing. But hey, people are getting saved. What's happening with you? You know, that's the question. You criticizing her dancing, and no, you ain't brought a person to Christ in all your Christian experience. Come on, somebody. Amen. Sister Porter?
Not feeling capable enough. They could have felt that way. Given that assignment, I'm here, but, you know I can't do it. But because they had the Holy Spirit,
that's true.
Insufficient.
Because you're right.
Yeah. In front of all these people.
If that endowment does not happen, you will always have that feeling, and you won't go.
Yeah.
And that's why you have to have it.
Mm-hmm.
That's why that's so important. That's why so many of us don't go. I'm just being real. I'm looking at my iPad right now, but that's why many of us won't go. Because we know that in our own self, we're just not sufficient. And I would imagine that it's either through lack of understanding or fear that we don't embrace what God wants for us. And so we stay where we are. We try to play it safe. Yeah. Let me say something here. Let me be free. We try to play it safe, and we don't even understand what safe is. Let me ask you a question, because the answer should be obvious. Are you ever safe not doing what God wants you to do? Are you ever in a safe place if you're not in the place where God wants you to be? So why are we trying to play it safe? The only safe place anywhere is where God wants you to be. No matter how crazy it looks, the safest place for David to be was on the battlefield with Goliath. That was the safest place. Might not make sense to you, does it?
But that's where God wanted him to be. He's safe there. See, you are safe. If you're fighting against 3 million people and they're all, you know, just warriors, if God wants you to be there, that's the safest place you could be. You are unsafe outside of the will of God, even if it looks like it's a peaceful place. And that's where most of us are spending our time. That's where most of us are spending our lives. We're spending our lives trying to be in nice, peaceful, safe places. And it's not safe because that's not where God wants you to be. You need an endowment from on high because God has a place ordained for you to be. And it's a safe place. You don't see it as a safe place, but it's a safe place because you're where he wants you to be. Sister Edna?
Sister Lorenda might remember this song the choir used to sing years ago that she soloed. The safest place in the whole wide world is in the will of God. Amen. And you know, there's times when the Spirit will move us to say something to somebody, to encourage somebody. You see people all the time wanting change. I give change. I keep change in my ashtray. Most folks don't smoke. You know, you throw change in your ashtray. But while I'm sharing with them, I have opportunity to minister. Now, an unsafe place is if the Spirit tells you to talk to that person, and then you don't.
That's right.
You're hesitant, or you're fearful, or you walk away, or you know, you get a Moses mindset, Lord, I can't talk out of my words, you know, whatever, you know. Then and as soon as you move from that spot, Pastor Leon, you're in an unsafe place because you are out of his will.
That's right. That's what I'm saying. That's exactly what I'm saying. We're trying to play it safe because we think we know what safe is. And we are mistaken because the safe place is in the will of God. It's where God wants you to be. That's the safe place. Let's take a look at something here for ourselves, because we are, by time and space, removed from the life of the apostles. We have our own giants that we're going to face. Major challenges in our own time, in our own life, in our own country. And because of these giants, remember, we cannot conquer them or overcome them through human instrumentality, we need this same endowment of the supernatural activity of God in our lives in order to conquer. What might they be for us today? Because there's no use us talking about the giants they faced. We're facing, I'm too busy facing my own giants to worry about 2,000 years ago somebody facing theirs. I've got my own giants to deal with. What are we dealing with now that are giants that we need an endowment from on high? That we can't overcome through human instrumentality. We cannot overcome through human strength and human strategy. We need an outpouring of the Holy Spirit on our lives today to empower us to know victory in these situations. What are they? Let's think for a moment, because if you don't know what giants you're facing, you won't be able to giant-proof your walk. Okay, that's the answer for the issue, but what are the giants? What are the giants we're facing? What are giants we're facing?
It could be on your job, a supervisor telling you to do something, you know, goes against what God has called
you to do. That's right. That's right. It can be something as simple as that, because in your human strength, there's nothing you can do. They're your supervisor. Okay, let's go bigger. I'm talking about giants, man. I'm talking about giants. Financial. Okay. Yes, it can be, because it's nothing that they can do. It's very little that they can do in their own strength to change that situation. Okay. All right. Yeah.
And something built up in her that I knew I couldn't deal with.
Yeah, because you tried to do whatever you could do to reconcile, and it's just she just wasn't going with that. And so whatever you tried wasn't working, and you just have to literally put it in God's hands. What are some of the really big giants we're facing today?
The homosexuality agenda.
Homosexuality, its agenda.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Will we do it?
Yeah.
I think that that's one, because not only that is happening out there, but to some people within the church, it's happening within their whole family.
Yes.
Their son or their daughter decided that they were going to come out.
Yes. Yeah.
Would you still, you know?
Sure.
So I think that that's a big giant.
It's a big giant. Right, it's a big giant.
In here now.
It's a big giant. The reason why it's a big giant is because, I guess when I was younger, probably in my 20s, the world was different. The world was different in that the average person, even the average unsaved person, understood that the Bible was right and would even confess that to be true. And so the world at that time had a certain kind of regard and respect for the Word of God, for God and the church. Today, it's totally different. As a matter of fact, we are fast becoming a minority in our thinking, and the secular community is becoming stronger and stronger and literally blackballing anybody that would go against what it says. And so before, for instance, 20 years ago, you could stand up and speak against homosexuality and almost the homosexuals would agree with you. Today, not only are the homosexuals disagreeing with you, but half of the secular community is with them, disagreeing with you. That's right. That's right. So the whole world has changed. Its mindset has changed. Its force against the church has changed. It's a giant. And people are almost afraid to say anything for fear of the reprisals. That's right.
God is love, and he made me this way.
Yeah.
So
when I talk about a giant, I'm talking about something that is so big that you could never fight against the world in your own strength. You need the supernatural activity of the Spirit of God operating in you to stand and to speak out. And to hold on to truth and to espouse or to teach and preach that truth, irregardless of what people will do to blackball you. That's why Jesus told them, don't go anywhere until you are endued with power from on high, because you are going to face some giants. If there is ever a time in the life of the church where there is a need for an endowment from on high, it is now. It is now. probably more so than any other time in the life of the church. We can't look back on the apostolic age and say, boy, that was nice for them. This is something we have to desire for ourselves and pray that God would pour out his spirit with power upon us today in order for us to be able to stand. Because in this day, many churches are going to acquiesce and compromise. And they will not teach the word of God because it will be offensive to people, and they will literally say what people want to hear. Just like Paul is writing to Timothy. These people, they will not endure sound doctrine, but they, after their own lust, will heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they will turn away their ears from the truth and be turned unto fables or light teaching that satisfies them. That's what that is. Sister Flo? Okay, unforgiveness. That's true. Yeah. Yeah. Because sometimes people can hurt you so much so. They can mess over you in such a bad way. It really takes the Spirit of God operating in you to forgive them. We talked about that on Sunday with Saul and David. Saul pursued David all over the country trying to put him to death. And David, all David ever did for Saul was to try to support him, help him, be dedicated to him, and faithful to him. I can imagine that if somebody messed over on you like that, I don't know if you would be as gracious as David. Took the anointing for him to respond to Saul in such a forgiving manner. Pastor Leon? Yeah. 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 Sure. Yeah. Sure. Absolutely.
And when you're talking about even with Saul and David, it's the Spirit of God that kept me, you know,
sure. Sure.
Consistent.
Yeah.
Kept me trying.
Praise God.
Let me know when to back off.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Sure, sure. Yeah.
Man, I've been all over the place trying to get to her.
Yeah.
In that mindset, but God kept me in a way, you know, that all I could do was love her.
Praise God. Praise God.
Of what she did. And what is so incredible is that, and I showed this to Michelle, and maybe I told you a few weeks ago, she was going through a situation on her Facebook, and I helped her, and it was encouraging too. I shared with her, and I told her I love her, and she said, I love you too, Dad.
Praise God.
And I hadn't heard that in years.
Praise God. Amen.
And it was on Facebook where thousands of people could see.
Praise God. Yes.
Phone,
yes.
But she said that.
Mm. Yes. Yes. Praise God. Yes. Yes.
I know it was the grace of God and the Spirit of God.
Praise God.
Working in me.
Amen. Amen.
To do it in the way that God can do it.
Yes. Praise God. Praise God. And we have, obviously, all of us have those kinds of situations in our own lives where we are dealing with our personal giants. And then there are corporate giants where all of us have to deal with together and fight together and believe God together to conquer giants that are so big that in the face of these giants, we don't know what to do apart from what the Spirit of the Lord leads us to do. And so that's why this is so important. Benny, did I see your hand, or Brother Branson? I saw you come forward. Did you have something you wanted to share? I'm bringing the mic so that they can hear you in Streamland.
Because what I have to say, you said it so well, and I don't know how you know what I was about to say, but you taking it to another level. It had to do with being politically correct.
Yes, sir.
That's what I say. That is all in the new. Everywhere you bring up anything that has to do with spiritual correctness,
yes,
or something to do with the biblical understanding,
yeah,
it is not politically correct,
yep,
to do it in the high societies,
yep,
that we have in the Congress.
Sure.
Anywhere this goes, that takes it away from what the real truth.
Yes.
The Civil Liberties Union people, and this holds out there that you can't do so much because it's not politically correct, mm-hmm, and they will hold it up for the secular society.
Absolutely.
And you said it so much. I don't know. That was better than I can say it, but that's what my big joint.
Yeah, that's the same principle, the same idea, the same notion. Oftentimes in the church, we're doing the things that they're doing in the world. The world is doing what it's doing because the world is trying to play it safe. For them, the safe place is to be politically correct, even though it's far away from what God wants. And they think they're safe because they're all in the same boat together. Well, there's a whole lot of people that's going to be in the same boat together and all of them in hell together. You're not safe just because you're with other people. You're safe when you're with God, even if you're by yourself. I mean, consider if you've ever read the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah is the principal example of not playing it safe in the way that the world sees it. Jeremiah was sharing things that God told him to share that was just so politically incorrect. And he was just stepping on toes everywhere he went. He was offending people and speaking death that was imminent, that was on its way to Jerusalem. I mean, he's speaking death everywhere he went. People hated to see him come. As a matter of fact, they threw him in a dungeon and just fed him bread and water. Now, they didn't want to hear him. They didn't want to see him. They didn't want to have anything to do with him. But he knew that the safe place, watch this, the safe place was in the dungeon with bread and water in the will of God. That's the safe place. That's the safe place. Watch this. When they came and sacked Jerusalem, Jeremiah's still kicking it. He was not taken into captivity. All of these other guys that were ragging on him, bagging on him, and trying to do away with him, they were either killed or taken into captivity. Jeremiah's just kicking it. In the safe place, in the will of God, huh? In the will of God. What are the giants you're facing? What are the giants we're facing corporately as a congregation in a secular world, in a world that's gone crazy and so far from God? What are we going to be able to do, and how are we going to be able to do that to face these giants unless we are endued with power from on high? This supernatural endowment that gifts the body of believers to actually operate in a world in such an incredible way that people know that we have to be people of God to be able to do these kinds of things, to take these kinds of stands, to be able to do in the face of persecution and ugliness, still stand and proclaim the goodness of God. Sister Laster?
Going to speak in an individual,
right.
And I was thinking a person, a family that's going through cancer, patient, but the church can be cancerous as well,
yes,
because it's deteriorating, the body is deteriorating, and so it could work both ways, but it's definitely, it's another giant.
Yeah. That's that's a giant. A giant, this is odd, but it's true. Paul is facing, and the early church is facing, the giant of Judaism. Today, we are facing the giant of a liberal church. that is so given over to secular thinking, and it is now becoming the prominent arm and representation of Jesus to the world. And the rest of us are looked at as if we are really oddballs to still believe this word for what it really says. Where homosexuals are trying to prove from Scripture that God endorses practicing homosexuality. And you right-wingers, you right-winging church people, still believe that God only endorses one kind of relationship between a man and a woman? And after a while, your fight is not going to be against secular community. It's going to be against the church. Because the church is starting to preach it, espouse it, and live it. So that now they're ordaining gay bishops in the Presbyterian Church. That's the fight that we will have. That's the giant we will have to overcome. And while the war has always been against the secular world that the enemy is reigning and ruling in, now it's becoming the church. It is changing so dramatically where sin is no longer an issue for people. They really believe that they're forgiven for all of their sins, past, present, and future. So it doesn't matter how you live anymore, because all your sins are already taken care of by the blood of Jesus. You don't have to worry about sin. It's a non-issue. You can live any way you really want to live. All of your sin is forgiven, past, present, and future. I've heard renowned people say that on television. They never use any scripture. They just tell you that that is so. And so now sin is a non-issue. That's incredible. All of the teaching that the Apostle Paul does in all of his epistles concerning sin. Sin is actually spoken of more probably than any other subject in the Bible other than God. It's spoken of much more than love. And yet, today, it's spoken of as if it's a non-issue, even though the whole of the New Testament is constantly dealing with sin. It's a giant that we are going to confront in this generation. And we're going to need an endowment from on high to stand for holiness and truth. Amen? Yes. Amen. Let's pray. Let's pray. Father, we come into your presence right now, recognizing that we live in serious times. We have never known the state of the church to be this way. We have never known the mindset of believers to be so far removed from the truth that was once delivered to the saints. Some of the things that are being espoused and taught and preached today boggle our minds because they are so contrary to what the scriptures clearly teach. We recognize that there are giants before us, and we are unable to do battle in our own strength. We are understanding more fully why you told your disciples not to leave Jerusalem until they were endued with power from on high. And that power was manifested in all kinds of giftings and abilities to slay giants. We need that endowment. We need that outpouring. We need your power to possess us, your spirit to rule and reign within us, to manifest your power in the darkness so that light cannot be covered up, that it would expose the darkness and bring life and health and wholeness to a dark and dying world. We are indeed salt and light. and you want us to impact the world, but we recognize we're not going to be able to do it if we're just relying on methodology, strategy, and human strength. So God, we're crying out to you tonight because we really need you to pour out your Spirit upon the church in this age, in order that all of these gifts and all of these supernatural things that you desire to do will flow in and through us, so that we will be able to speak a word that is prophetic, that we will be able to speak a word that is a word of wisdom and a word of knowledge, that we will be able to lay our hands on the sick and they shall recover. We will be able to do those things, God, that will reflect your awesome power, that men might come to know that you are real. We know that it's not going to happen by just winning an argument or a debate with the ungodly. It's going to happen if you manifest your power in and through your people. And so we bow before your throne and ask you in the name of Jesus that if there is anything in us that is in the way of you pouring out your Spirit upon us, we pray in the name of Jesus that first you'll forgive us of it and then that you will eradicate it from us. That we would be people that are pure before you because of the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus, and that we would become vessels of honor fit for the Master's use, that you can do through us what you've always desired to do through us, to impact the lost for Jesus. You've given us a commission. We want to fulfill it, but we recognize, God, our own human frailty and weakness. So take us out of it and allow us to operate in the fullness of the Spirit of Jesus for your glory. We give ourselves to you afresh, and we're praying for an outpouring of your Spirit upon us for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 We're going to invite the ushers to come receive our offering. Those of you that may have announcements, we're going to ask that you would go ahead and give them at this time. We'll receive them in the name of Jesus. Any announcements? All right, Koinonia Mass Choir, practicing at Willow Street Church of God in Long Beach at 1 o'clock on Saturday. Any other announcements? Michelle, do you have those badges? You can give them to Jean if you have them. Yeah. Sister Lassa, did you say something? Okay.
And so the lady told me, she said, we don't stand for no foolishness, man. She said, if they come in and they're homosexual, they change. She said, if they come in and they're chatting up,
they change.
They can't have any participation in the church.
Praise God.
And so I said, oh, I'm going to watch them in the church.
All of us need change. You know, anybody that comes to Jesus and they have a relationship with Jesus, they change. You can't have a relationship with Jesus and not change. All of us need change.
Amen.
My sin manifested itself in me in a way differently from maybe you. But we all needed change because we were all in sin. And we thank God for his grace and his mercy that brings change to our lives. Glory. Any other announcements? Any further? Sister Shell?
$8 to $10.
All right, can't do any better than that. IHOP can't beat that.
Amen.
Amen. Denny's can't beat that.
Amen.
So come and have some hot pancakes with Blessed Family Covenant Church And they'll give you some syrup as well. Sister Edna. Okay. Oh, okay. Okay. Good. Good. Praise God. All right. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hey, if you have a friend that you can invite to come to church on Sunday, give them an invitation. Let's continue to try to have people to come and share the good things of God. If you have a neighbor, coworker, a friend, invite them to come to church. You never know what God might do to touch their hearts. Sister Edna?
I received a text message that our niece Roberta, Mod's wife, is in the hospital.
Okay.
They thought their family was real complete. She found out she was too much pregnant.
Oh.
And so she got pretty sick and they had to put her in the hospital. But I got the message now that they gave her medication for the nausea and stuff, and the Mod said the baby was doing well.
Okay. I didn't know if she had gotten sick from hearing she was pregnant or from actually being pregnant. Yeah, after you had a few children and you don't want any more, you might get sick from hearing you have another child on the way. All right, let's stand together. So good to see all of you here tonight. So good to see Sister Allison back in town after a trip out of the state. So good to see her back in the city. And she's back with us safely, and that's a good thing. Praise God. Amen. And those of you that also you took a trip, whether mentally or physically, it is so good to see you back here tonight. Amen. You know, some of us can only take a trip in our minds. Yeah, we go to Hawaii every week. Dreaming it. Praise God. Today? Oh, well, amen, amen, praise God. All right, well, we pray that you'll have a blessed rest of the week and that your ongoing birthday celebration will be a blessing to you. Amen, praise God. I'm going to ask if Sister Allison would pray our closing prayer for us. Thank you. Go right ahead. Yes. Yes, Father. Yes, Lord. Please. Yes. Greet somebody. Greet somebody. greet somebody before you leave out, before you run to get your toilet tissue. Greet somebody. If there's anybody else, Gina, you can...